I want you to grab your Bible. Hopefully you bring your Bible to church. Hopefully you bring your Bible to church. Amen. Let me see your Bibles. Put them up in the air. If you're a Christian, you should have a Bible. And you shouldn't be embarrassed. If you're embarrassed of your Bible, God may be embarrassed of you. Ooh, ow, stop that. Shake it up there and make the devil nervous. Amen. How many of you know he don't really get nervous when you shake your Bible? But he gets nervous when he thinks you're going to put what's in the Bible into your heart and let it start coming out your mouth. Amen. You can shake your Bible all you want. The devil's not going to mind. But he sees that thing start going into your heart, changing your heart, and then words of faith start coming out of your mouth. He knows his days are done. Amen. Wave it around. Say, this is my Bible.
It's my Bible.
It is the Word of God.
It's the Word of God.
And I believe it.
I believe it.
Now, I want you to say this with some conviction. Say, I am.
Everything
the Bible says I am. Say, I can do
everything
the Bible says I can do. Say, I can have
everything
the Bible says I can have. Say,
I'm being transformed
not by the removing, but by the renewing of my mind. Amen. Hit your head with that Bible. Let's just see if it'll go in there by osmosis or something. Amen. God is good. Are you out there? God is good and he's on your side. And I don't care if it's never looked that way. You need to give God a chance because he wants to do something good in your life. He wants to show himself strong in your life. Are you out there? He wants to see you become who he called you to be. Someone of confidence and of love and of power, victory. Are you out there? I said, are you out there? Because,
yes.
You know, we're talking about what you say about yourself matters. And basically what I'm talking about is what you say about you comes from what you believe about yourself. And the most important thing in your life is what you believe about you. Because what you believe about you, how you see you, determines what you believe about God and how you see him and what you think he is able to do in your life. And I've only been at this for 30 years, so I'm kind of new, but I have watched a lot of professing Christians walk around like carnal people without a God, without their God, because they don't believe what he says about them, and they keep talking about who they used to be and how they used to be, and they fail to act on the promises and the blessings of God because they really don't believe they're good enough for God to bless. Amen. Whether you like that or not, it's the truth. Because what holds you back isn't the devil. What holds you back isn't other people. It's not how you were brought up. What holds you back is how you think about you. What holds you back is you living in the past instead of in your future with Christ. And God needs you to do something. Are you out there? Every one of you in here, I don't care if you're born again, unborn again. God has a picture for you. He's got a life for you. And he's got people that you may be the only one who can connect with to lead them to him. There are a lot of people I'm never going to meet that you're going to meet. And Jesus is looking for you to be his voice in their life. Amen. And as much fun as it is, God is not concerned about all of our playthings. He doesn't mind you having the playthings as long as they don't take his place in your life. When he becomes number one in your life, then you can have the other things as long as they don't take his place. But our number one desire should be for God, not for the toys, not, you know, how many of you know Carlos, one of our members here? He brought a Corvette to church today, and Corvettes are kind of my weakness. And I wouldn't mind having one. My birthday's coming up, you know. Just a little hint, just. But I'm not going to give up God for a Corvette, is what I'm saying. Are you out there? I would much rather have God and have his goodness, his blessing, than a Corvette, You keep the Corvette if it means I got to give up God, or if that's going to take me away from God. Are you out there? So many people see God as good and great, but they don't ever relate that to their own life, that He has created us in His image to sit with Him and be with Him and be like Him on the earth. Amen. If I can just be honest with you, the Bible tells us that each one of us is supposed to be doing the same things on earth that Jesus did. In fact, He said greater things. And don't you have to wonder when you watch most Christians what's going on? Because not many Christians do much. Not many Christians are laying hands on the sick folks and preaching the gospel. And it's because people intimidate them, because they don't know who they are. You shouldn't be intimidated by people. You should know who's the greater one on the inside of you is. And there should be a boldness for the things of God, not a rudeness or a crudeness, but a boldness for the things of God, because you are confident in who you are in Him. And you know that the people without Christ are going to hell. There is a hell, and it's coming. And our job is to make sure as few people go there as possible. Amen. And so you and I, we're supposed to be empowered by the Holy Ghost to change the image of ourselves so that we can be who God called us to be and not so concerned about whether we have the right selfie. So what I'm talking about is your new identity in Jesus. When I talk about what you say about you is important, what you say about you should come from your new identity in Christ. Not your old identity. You know, my wife and I, we travel quite a bit, and we have a passport, and you have to renew the passport every 10 years. And sometimes a photo changes a little in 10 years. But when you go into countries, that passport identifies you to the new country. And a lot of not you, but other people that we preach to on Sunday mornings in church, they're carrying around an old identity passport from their old life that's identifying who they are, rather than getting a new passport that identifies them as being with Christ. They carry out an old passport that says, well, I'm a divorcee, I'm an alcoholic, I'm a loser, rather than getting a new passport that says, I'm a winner, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, God likes me, God's on my side. They carry around the old passport that says, I'm not very good. I screw up everything I touch, and nobody likes me, and they make fun of me. And are you getting what I'm saying here? You need to get your new identity from God and get a new passport picture that says who you are in Christ, rather than running around with that old identity that doesn't get you anywhere. Amen. Hallelujah. So most people believe that God is going to do something in their life, and a lot of times they think, nowadays especially, they think, well, you know, I'll just come up and somebody lay hands on me and praise God, I'll be fall on the floor and I'll be changed and I'll be okay. Well, you know, laying hands on people is a good start. But Brother Hagin's wife, Aretha, she used to tell us at Rhema, she'd say, you know, even when you get up off the floor, you still have to do the Word of God. And I think what a lot of people don't realize is that growing in Christ is a process. Amen. The Bible says first the seed, then the ear, then the corn on the ear. There's a process of growth. And what a lot of times we don't realize is we have to start with the seed of the Word, and then we have to work the Word, confess the Word, believe the Word, until we come to that place of maturity where we actually begin to change and where we begin to grow and the things of God actually become more common in our life. Y'all follow me? And a lot of people, they think, well, Pastor laid hands on me, but I still have problems, so it must not work. Well, no, you have a part to play. When you get up off the floor, thank God, I've had a lot of times on the floor, man, it gave me a jump start and some stuff, but I still had to work on me. Y'all follow what I'm saying? And so, you know, the new identity, in your spirit, you're a new creation, but you still have flesh and stuff to deal with. And it takes time sometimes to work out the difficulties in the flesh. Are you out there? Amen. So turn over, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 with me. Amen. Because God has things to say about us, and we actually have to read what God says and then believe what God says. You know, and it's amazing to me how many people, they read what God says, but they don't really believe it about themselves. Because if I can be perfectly honest with you, a lot of us have grown up with a lot of negativity in our life, a lot of bad things said about us and done to us, and we just really can't believe that God would even like us. But I can tell you for a fact, God likes you. He's on your side. Amen. And he wants to do something good. How many know that, you know, when you're born again, you're a citizen of heaven, not hell. You're a new creation, and the old man, the old person is dead and gone. Do you hear me? Dead and gone, so don't be waking him up. Some of y'all keep waking the dead guy up, like, let's go party. No, leave him there. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, watch this. It says, therefore, I want you to get this. This is our golden text for this, but I want you to get this. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, verse 17 is, how many know what the name of this church is? New Creation Church. What a coincidence. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a... Oh, this is looking good. If anyone is in Christ, that's being born again, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Amen. Now, when Jesus was on the earth, he was traveling around. He was, you know, around 30 years old. He's getting ready to start his ministry. And people are going, who's this clown think he is? That's Mary's kid. We've known him since he was in diapers. It's a carpenter's boy. What's he mouthing off about all this Bible stuff? I mean, we know who you are, Jesus. You're from Nazareth, one of the worst towns in the country. Right? They're like, who in the world do you think you are? But now that he has been put to death, resurrected, we know he is the Christ. We know he is the Son of God. We don't see him the way we used to. Now we see him as who he really is. I want you to follow this because the Bible says that you're not supposed to judge other people or yourself by that same way. You may have used to have been that kid, the troublemaker, the divorcee, the sick person, the liar, the cheat, the drug addict, the alcoholic, the smoker. But now that you're born again, we don't see you that way anymore. Are you following this? You can't identify, you can't allow what you used to be. Jesus isn't still known as just the carpenter's kid. He's known as the Son of God. You're not known in God's kingdom as the alcoholic or the divorcee. Now you're known as a child of the living God, seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Are you following this? And it's important that you get this. It's important that you change how you look at you so it lines up with the Word so that you can walk in all the blessings that God has for you. Because you cannot walk in God's blessings if you still identify with the divorcee. You still identify with the drug addict. You still, you know, with the prostitute. You still identify with whatever you used to do. That ain't you anymore. But the devil, he likes to bring back movies and show you how you used to be to convince you that's still you. And you need to say, shut up, devil, that ain't me. That person's dead. And he'll go, yeah, I know you. We used to have fun drinking. You go, I don't know what you're talking about. Yeah, you know what we're talking about. No, I don't remember. That person's dead. And you have to have that idea in order to move on with the things of God. Because I'm going to tell you, how you see yourself, how you interact with yourself, how you relate to yourself, what you believe about yourself will hinder or allow God to work in your life. God, I'm going to tell you the truth. Every one of us in here, God has says, I have something great for you. I have a land flowing with milk and honey. I've got prosperity. I've got healing. I've got blessing. I've got freedom from fear, freedom from doubt, freedom from anxiety. He says there's more than enough money to take care of all your needs. And he's saying all this stuff in the Word, but how many people are actually grabbing it? Why? Because they really don't believe they're worthy or that he could do anything or that that would work for them. Amen. Thank you for those holy murmurs. That was good. That was awesome. So turn over to Numbers chapter 13. Y'all okay? Before you turn there, I want to go back to 2 Corinthians from the Message Bible, and I want to read verse 17. Y'all got to do with that? 2 Corinthians 5:17 from the Message, it says, "Now we look inside, and what we see is that anyone united with the Messiah gets a fresh start." Man, I like that. "Is created new." Amen. So you're created new. You're not just cleaned up like an old mattress and refurbished. You're created new, a new creation. Amen. So don't drag around the old man anymore. The old life is gone, and this is my favorite word. I just love this. The old life is gone, a new life burgeons. Man, don't you just love it? Burgeons. I'm burgeoning. Burgeoning means to increase, to flourish. And so your new life, who you are in Christ, should be burgeoning. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm the King's son or daughter. I'm okay. Man, you wake up in the morning, step out on your front porch and just burgeon a little bit. Bless the Lord. God is on my side. All my needs are met according to his riches and glory. I'm burgeoning with the good news of God. And quit listening to your neighbors. So back to Numbers. You okay? Now this is the good group, right? Okay. Numbers chapter 13. Numbers 13. Now, this is the story of the children of Israel. They've been delivered from Egypt. God delivered them. Remember the Red Sea and all that stuff? Anybody remember that? I mean, does it make you wonder how you can see all the miracles they saw and then still leave God? How they can watch the Red Sea part and they go through it, and then 3 weeks later, you just... Where are we? That's how we are. But God says, he says, "I delivered you from Egypt, and now I'm going to take you into a land flowing with milk and honey. I'm going to take you into a land where all your needs are met, where the blessings overflow. You're going to have the best food, the best water, everything you ever wanted. I'm going to give it to you right there." And then they come up with a good idea. Let's go check it out first. In other words, I don't believe God. We should check this out for ourselves. And so they send the spies in. Remember that? And they go in, and they come back with grapes. It takes two of them to haul back a cluster of grapes. Are you out there? What'd God say? God says, "I got something great for you. Man, I got something good for you." And they say, "Well, we should check it out first." And then in Numbers 13, verse 27, it says, they came back and it says, "We went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless," how many know nevertheless is like but? Not trying to be crude, but you got to watch out what comes after the big but. "But the people who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and all the other Terminites." Can I tell you something? When God tells you about a promise, he knows the obstacles that are there, but he doesn't tell you because he knows you'll freak out. He says, just watch me. Just pay attention to me. Don't look around. Are you out there? Because some of you, God has said to do something, and you're like looking around, like, "Oh, my God, did you see?" He knew all that stuff was there. But how many of you know it didn't bother him any? He's not going, "Oh, no, the Amorites are there? I forgot about that. Oh, the giants? Oh, I forgot they were there. Then, verse 30, then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. Somebody actually knew God. And Caleb goes, who cares what's out there? God's on our side. Let's go get it. Some of you, not in this room, but other rooms, God has put new jobs, businesses, opportunities in your path. And the first thing you saw were the obstacles. And instead of saying, I can do it, you said, ooh, look at that obstacle. God's going, forget the obstacle. In one word, I can take care of the obstacle. I just need you to get joined up with me and do something. Are you out there? God wants you to be prosperous. He wants you to be blessed. He wants you to be so blessed you make other people jealous, as long as that doesn't interfere with your relationship with Him. He don't care how much money you have. As long as at the drop of a hat, you could give it away, not bother you a bit. He doesn't care if I drive a Corvette. He didn't care when I drove a Mercedes or a BMW. What He cares about is where is my heart. He doesn't care if you live in a nice house. Amen. 31. But the man who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger. Who were they looking at for the answer? They were looking at them for the answer. God said, I just need you to go, because if you go, then I can go, and if I go, I will take care of it. Amen. Huh. But verse 32, and they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone is spies as a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people that we saw, they're men of great stature. Oh, God, oh, help us. And there we saw the giants. Oh, no, giants, help us. Watch this. And we were like grasshoppers in our own sight. How did they see themselves? They didn't see themselves as mighty men of valor. They didn't see themselves as conquering. They didn't see themselves as alongside God and a God alongside them. I mean, he knew all that stuff was there. He could have taken care of it with one word, but they're just looking at themselves. We can't do it. We just little grasshopper people. You just, ooh, help. And I'm convinced this is in here because there's a lot of Christians that have grasshopper mentality that keeps them from grabbing hold of the things of God and the big things, things that are much bigger than they've ever done before. Because in their sight, they're just grasshoppers. They can't handle it. It's too much. And listen to me. The way they saw themselves kept them out of the blessing of God. I want you to get that. God was wanting to bless them. He led them to the blessing. He told them what to do about the blessing, and they said, we can't do it. I want you to stir up. You need to change your identity from a grasshopper to a child of the living God. You need to quit letting your past dictate how you see yourself. You need to get a new identity that is related to the Word of God and related to your relationship with Christ, because once you find out who you are in Christ, you'll quit treating other people so crappy. The reason most people are so hard to get along with is because they really see themselves in such a poor light. And you cannot treat anybody else better than the way you see you. Amen. Tough guys are just scared guys. Mean people are just hurt people. And they won't get fixed according to the Word, so they continue it on. And they continue just pushing people away, hurting people. There's enough hurt people. What we need are some people who know who they are in Christ, who can actually love somebody without having to be defensive about it. Who can actually love someone more than themselves without it bothering them. Who can actually be nice and don't need a thank you. But because we know who we are in Christ, we're well able to do everything that Christ did and not let what everybody else says bother us. There's a whole lot of marriages that would be better if the people involved in the marriage would get better, so that your spouse didn't have to put up with you. Y'all sometimes make it hard for people to put up with you, and you're married to them. Man, there ought to be so much love. Gentleness, kindness, thoughtfulness. Am I talking to anybody this morning? Don't raise your hand. Numbers chapter 14, verse 6 says, Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, the land we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. Listen, the job opportunity you passed up because you didn't think you were good enough, the whatever you passed up because you didn't think you could do it, is a good opportunity. Verse 8 says, if the Lord delights in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Watch verse 9. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people, for the land, for they are our bread, their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. And then all the people spoke up, and all the congregation said, stone them with stones. Can I just tell you that when you're bold in the things of God, the weenies are going to stone you? You don't get stoned by brave people. You get stoned by cowards. Strong people don't rip into you. Weak people do. Amen? You want to be the strong people. Turn over to Daniel chapter 1. Y'all all right? I know this is good, but it's all right. Daniel chapter 1. If you come to this church, I'm going to tell you, I have an expectation. And my expectation is that you become exceedingly strong in the things of God. Not brash or rude or crude, but strong in the things of God, so that when a situation arises, you are well able to take care of it. And no matter what the devil brings up before you, you don't need to get 1,500 people to pray for you. You can handle it. Are you hearing me? I want you to get this. I want this church to be known that when you pray, when you walk in, God comes on the scene. And you're not so insecure about where you are that you don't know if God's going to heal you, deliver you, set free, or do anything. You know from the Word of God that all my needs are met. I don't care what the devil throws up. He can't steal my stuff. He can't steal my kids. Can't steal my health. Can't have nothing. Are you following me? You need to get to that place where you know, if you need prayer, praise God, we will pray for you. But my desire is for you that you don't need us to pray for you every week. You get to the place you can do your own praying, your own believing, and then you can pass it on. Are you out there? Yeah, now listen to me. It's really cool to have people come up and want you to pray for them. That's awesome. But I'm not addicted to praying for you. I don't get my self-esteem because you come and let me pray for you. Where I would get my self-esteem is if you never need prayer and you live a good life and you're strong and the blessings of God are flowing on you and your life is doing good. And you're reaching other people and making disciples and helping other people come to Jesus. Are you out there? Because if you spend your whole Christian life in need of prayer, there's something wrong with our teaching. God did not get you born again so you could remain a baby for the rest of your life. He got you born again so so that you could find out who you are in Christ, and so that you could operate in the fullness of a born-again Christian that knows their authority, knows what the victory of Christ is all about, and then you can be nice to other people. Amen. Man, that was good. So Daniel, chapter 1. Y'all find Daniel, chapter 1? If you haven't found it, quit looking because you ain't going to get it. Listen, Daniel, out of all the people in the Bible, is one of the few people that had no negative things against him. He didn't have sex with people he wasn't married to. He didn't lie, cheat, and all that stuff. He had a clean rep. Are you out there? And so when the Babylonians came into his city, they killed his parents. They took him as a captive, made him a slave, and he became a slave in a Babylonian place, you know, that he didn't know anything about. And they took him, just took him away, and then they were going to feed him the king's food and make him some kind of a waiter for the king. Are you out there? So Daniel chapter 1 verse 6 says, "Now from among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah." These are their Jewish names. "To them the chief of the eunuchs, who is a Babylonian, gave them names. He gave Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego." Now, if you've been around the Bible, you've heard of the other three guys, right? Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, fiery furnace, all that. But you never hear of Daniel being called, hardly at all ever, Belteshazzar. He's always referred to as Daniel. Why? Because he made a determination. Watch this, verse 8 says, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself." He wouldn't take the food, and he wouldn't take the new name. Come on. Daniel was always known as Daniel, the Hebrew name that was given to him by his godly parents. And he says, "I'm not taking your Babylonian name because that's not who I am. I'm Daniel." Some of you have taken the new name of divorcee, drug addict, alcoholic, whatever, loser. You should have left that name and said, "No, I'm not taking that name anymore. I got a new name and it's Daniel," or whatever your name is. And you need to proclaim what the new name is and quit calling yourself by that old name. The world wants to call you hurt. The world wants to call you sick. The world wants to call you poor. The world wants to call you incapable. The world wants to call you insecure. But that's not who you are. You need to rise up and say who you are. This is my name according to the word of God. And I'm not loser. I'm not almost could have done it. I'm not always screw up. This is who I am. And the reason you keep acting the same way is because you keep talking about yourself the old way. And until you change who you are up here, change who you are in here, and start saying who you are out of here, you're going to stay the old way. Because you have to agree with God. And then you have to proclaim out of your mouth, "This is who I am." And as you believe it and you proclaim it, you will become it. Amen. But if you continue, "I'm sick, I'm poor, I'm..." There was a story I heard about a woman years ago. And she went to a counselor, and she had been abused by her husband physically, verbally, for years. And she's talking to the counselor, and the counselor's like, "Well, what's going on?" She says, "Well, I've been a victim for 15 years. My husband abuses me. He's just terrible to me." And she tells him all about this, and he's having compassion and everything. But he looks at her and he says, "Ma'am, I don't mean to hurt your feelings, but you were not a victim those 15 years. You may have been a victim the first couple weeks." He says, "After that, you became a volunteer." I want you to get that, because someone may try to victimize you, but if you don't know who you are, you will volunteer to stay there. You need to find out who you are and no longer be a victim to that abuse. Don't volunteer for it anymore. Because whatever's going on in your life, you can find out from God who you really are, where you're really supposed to be, and start claiming that to override where the devil's got you or where you've been your whole life. Because I want you to understand, you know, the only reason you're a victim is because of a lack of knowledge. Once you find out who you are, if you continue in that, you're a volunteer. You volunteer for sickness. You volunteer for poverty. You volunteer for abuse. But if you find out who you are in Christ and you begin to stand on it, you'll quit volunteering. And you'll rise up and be who you are. In our circles with the Christian thing, a lot of women, even Christians, are abused by their husbands. And they think because they're Christians, they have to stick this out and stay with it. Let me just tell you, look you in the eyeball, ladies, if your husband's abusing you, get away from him. You don't have to sit and take it. Pray for him, but get out. But Pastor, we're married and God did not put you in the relationship so you could be abused for the rest of your life. Get out, pray that he'll change. If he changes, move back. If he don't, goodbye. Same way with the devil. If he's abused you all your life with sickness and disease and insecurity, move out. Quit living with that kind of thinking. Quit living with that kind of abuse. That's not who God created you to be. Listen to me. I know none of you have ever done these kinds of things. But for the first 30 years of my life, well, probably 16 years, second 16 years, somewhere in there, between up to 30, I smoked and drank and did everything everybody else did. And a lot of the reason was just to forget life, to escape, to not have to deal with stuff. We didn't go in and start drinking and say, we're escaping. We just knew the plan. Thank God when you find God, you find Jesus, you find the Holy Ghost, you find the Word, you don't have to find excuses to escape life anymore. Because now life is good. Are you out there? I don't need to escape responsibility anymore. Now I can accept this responsibility and deal with it without having to get drunk or stoned to figure it out. Are you out there? So I don't identify. I mean, I started, my dad gave me my first beer when I was 6 or 7 years old. And then I wondered why I became an alcoholic. But I'm not that alcoholic. You know, there's a club called the AA for alcoholics. You ever hear that? I think their intentions are good, but one of the things they say is, you'll be an alcoholic forever. And you got to keep reminding yourself, no, you don't. You get saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, put the Word in, you get delivered, you're not still an alcoholic. You ever hear anybody say this? Well, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Well, make up your mind. Which one are you? You an old sinner or are you saved by grace? Because you can't be both. If you are saved by grace, you're not an old sinner anymore. You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. Are you following me? And you and I, we need to make up our mind which side of this thing we're going to live on. Am I going to live in the past or am I going to live in the future? As for me and my household, we're going to live in the future, praise God. Are you out there? So the world's trying to rename you, but don't let them. Stick with the name God gave you. Delivered, healed, set free, all my needs met. That's my name. Well, you're awful cocky. No, I just know where I am. See, to some weak people, when you know who you are, it appears like cockiness. But it's just because they're weak and don't know it, and it scares them. So that's when they want to pick up stones and stone you. But it's just because they don't know who they are. And don't let them intimidate you. You just still be, you know, don't be cocky around people, but get cocky with the devil. When he shows up, you just tell him where to go off. Ephesians chapter 4, you okay? Yeah. Ephesians 4, this is really good. Amen. I mean, you know, if you've been through a divorce, you're not a divorcee. Quit looking at yourself that way. Amen? You're a new creation. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22. Ephesians 4, 22. Now look at this. I want you to follow this, because when I opened this, I said, you're not going to get any hands laid on you quick remedy for your life. Okay? You've got to invest in it. You've got to put the word in, and you got to do something with it. Amen. You can't just, well, I went to church 4 times and I still suck. You do. Because going to church isn't the deal. It's where you start, but that's not where you end. Look at this. Verse 22, it says, you put off. Who's the intended person right here? Just poke your neighbor and put it on them. You put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. You, in other words, you deal with the drugs, you deal with the alcohol, you deal with the smoking, you deal with the cussing, you deal with the looking. Are you out there? Some people don't, Pastor, just pray for me that I won't drink anymore. Well, that's like praying for that you'll tithe. Pastor, pray that I'll want to come to church. I get a kick out of people. I just can't make it to church. I have to work and I have things to do. And then you see them rafting and you see them. That's funny. You have time for other things. People do what they want to do. Sorry. Verse 23 says, but be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Renew the spirit of your mind to the word of God and let the word change how you think, so that how you think will change how you do. Are you out there? I am. This is how it works. You plug in, you get born again, you get filled with the Holy Ghost, and then you put the word of God in you on a consistent, daily, several times a day basis, and you begin to do what it says. Are you out there? And then you begin to change, you begin to get stronger, and the stuff that used to follow you around just starts dropping off. But it doesn't drop off in a day. It don't drop off in a week. Sometimes it takes a year. And then sometimes you screw up and you do it again, and you just, instead of giving up, you just get back on the job and put it on. Amen? And you renew my mind to the things of God. Ooh. And verse 24 says that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. You gotta put that new man on. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am all that God says I am. I can do all that God says I can do. I can have all that God says I can have. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Are you out there? I mean, you can watch it and think about it, but you got to do it. Y'all, some of you just need to stand in front of the mirror and say, you're all right. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. Everything that you put your hand to prospers. Yeah, you don't understand. I screw everything up. Stop it. Say what the Bible says until you get to believe it, and then it begins to happen that way. Amen. Don't let your old self dictate how you're going to continue to live. Right? Turn over to Psalm 139. You okay? See, the old man is controlled by how you used to be, by the world, but the new man's got to be created by God and created for good things. Put on a new identity that's controlled by the Word of God. Amen. I knew you'd like that. Psalm 139. Verse 1, watch this. What does God say about you? That's what's important. Not what you say about you or what other people have said about you. What does God say about you? That's my new identity. Verse 1 says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. Man, don't you just like that? You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. How many know that He knows what you've been through? He knows where you've been. Are you out there? It's not a surprise to him. You didn't pop up and he goes, oh man, we've never dealt with this before. Woo. He says, no, I know you. I know where you're from. I know who you are. Verse 3 says, you comprehend my path and my lying down, and you are acquainted with all my ways. You know what I like about God? Is he loves me just the way I am. But he loves me too much to leave me the way I am. Amen. He loves me. He loves me the way he found me, but he loves me way too much to leave me that way. Thank you, Jesus. Are you out there? I said, are you out there? See, one of the biggest problems with ourselves is self-image or a sense of insecurity. And you need to know that God is with you. He's around you. He cares about you. I want to read this from verse 13. Now watch this. He says, for you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am. This ought to be news or good news to some of you. For I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. For I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works. You may not know your dad. Your mom might have went out and had sex with some guy and they don't even know who he is. But God, your father, knows who you are. Your mom might not have had any idea what she was doing. Maybe they both left you. But God, your father, when you were in the womb, he was forming you. And you might say, well, man, I got such big hips. What did he do that for? He's not concerned about the outer part. Well, I got the big bones, and I'm too short, and I'm too fat, and I'm with the grandbabies yesterday, or maybe it was this morning, with the grandbabies, and my littlest one, she looks and says, your nose is big. Now, don't you all be seeing me with a big nose from now on. And whenever she comes over, she jumps in my lap and she points at my mole and she's like, what is that? Why is that there? Because people are good at picking out flaws. God isn't looking at your personal flaws, because what he formed in the belly was not the exterior, it was the interior. And if you focus on the exterior, most all of us are going to be wanting. If you judge your life on what you look like, I remember when I was in grade school, I got beat up all the time because I was a thumb-sucking mama's boy. Because my dad wasn't around except to feed me beer when I was six. And I had big feet and I was skinny and I had a long, skinny neck. And have you ever noticed how people like to pick out your flaws? Not real good at theirs, but they can pick yours out. And a lot of us have spent our lives being the ones being made fun of. And that generally generates an attitude of how you respond to people. My response has always been, most all of my life till I got born again and filled with the Holy Ghost, has been, I'm going to kill you with my words before you get a chance to attack me with yours. You follow me? My whole life was made up of defensiveness rather than love, because I didn't believe I was worth loving. And if I'm not worth loving, you ain't worth loving, because you're probably just going to attack me and try to make me feel bad. Are you watching this? Whatever junk you have that you grew up with that's affecting how you treat people and how you act now, you need to get that aligned with the Word of God and who you are in Christ Jesus now, and not allow the hurt, the pain to continue to speak as to who you are. But you need to get a new address, a new identity of who you are in Christ. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. And the exterior isn't me. what's inside. That's me. You may not like my nose. You may not like somebody else's ears. You may not like their big hips. You may not like your own big hips. You may not like a bunch of stuff. But don't let that influence how you see them and how you act with them. And don't let it influence you and how you act with you. Amen? Because you are not the exterior person, you're the inside person. And God formed you from the time you were in the womb. Well, my parents left me. No, your daddy never left you. Well, nobody ever liked me. Your daddy always liked you. People always hurt me. No, but not your daddy. He was always on your side. He was always with you, loving you, calling you by your name, child of God. Amen? God is good, and he likes you. He loves you. He cares about you. And he sent Jesus into this world to pay the price for you so that you would know how much God cares about you. Because I remember before I met Jesus, we used to make fun of Jesus. We used to use his name in not good ways all the time. And he still loved me. When he died on the cross, he looked out into the future and he saw me cursing with his name. He says, I'm going for him anyway because I love him. And I know if I can get him to accept me, he'll come back. He'll be who he's supposed to be. Man, I'm so glad I came back. I'm so glad that I don't have to worry about if my neck is too long or my feet are too big or if I have a mole or if my nose is too big. I don't even think about it because it doesn't matter. All that matters is when I wake up and I know the love of God is with me and the Holy Ghost is with me and that nothing's impossible for me today. I wake up and I know no matter what anybody says, my job is just to do good and help them. Because their words can't hurt me. What they do can't hurt me. Because I'm going to heaven. And if I die today, I'm just going to heaven. So whatever you think about me, whatever people think about me, makes no difference. Man, I like that. Because I spent a lot of my life wondering what everybody was thinking about me. I'm so glad I don't have to anymore. God, thank you for that. Thank you. So, there is a hell. There's a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. And the only way you can change who you are is by receiving Christ as your Lord and Savior. Believing what he did on the cross, what the price he paid for you, receiving that and becoming a new creation. And letting the past begin to just go away. And there are some of you in here, maybe you've never received Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. And there might be some of you in here that you received Christ, but you've never lived up to it. You've just gone on your way. And it's time for you to realize God's called you to something more than just existing with the hopeful thought of going to heaven. He wants to empower you to do something today. And so maybe you're backslidden. You haven't been serving God. You're just going through the motions. But God says, I want to know you. I want to empower you. But you need to come back. You need to just rededicate and confess your sins and come back and let's get on with this thing. Amen.